about the same time D.W. Griffith was contributing a new flexibility and power to screen language, a distinctive line of American film comedy began that would produce its own geniuses and own masterworks. Although contrasting strongly with Griffith's sentimentality, in fact, sometimes subjecting those qualities to parody, the early film comics nonetheless contributed importantly to solving some basic problems of the art form with humor. The amount of laughter obtained could still vary considerably depending upon how it was presented. The requirements of a pictorial narrative, the selection and arrangement of shots were as important to the effectiveness of the comedians as they were to Griffith. One of Griffith's former co-workers and informal students, Mack, came to understand this newly evolved technique and put it into practice for comic purposes. Like Griffith, Sennett didn't invent so much as he applied insights gained from his own and others' experiments. His essential contribution was to fashion a kind of systematic, thought unarticulated comic aesthetic that would become a standard basis from which others would continue to develop. As with most film genre, screen comedy was present in embryonic form from the very beginning. In fact, before the screen, take for instance Fred Ott's Sneeze, 1893, one of Edison's peep show kinetoscope fragments. Then there were the French trick films begun by Millais. The trickery was usually designed for humorous as well as fantastic effect. Georges Millais' An Adventurous Automobile Trip, 1905, in many ways foreshadows Mack Sennett's later fun with the Model Ts. It was another Frenchman, Max Linder, who from 1905 on established most clearly a pattern for the kinds of visual incongruities and surprises that were to screen comedy what verbal gags were to stage burlesque and vaudeville. The comic figure he created was a dapper, upper-class man about town, involved with a hard-hearted lady love. Sennett admitted to having studied Linder closely, and Sennett's most brilliant discovery, Charles Chaplin, was even more obviously in Linder's debt. In Chaplin's first films for Sennett, before he developed his tramp persona, his costume and mannerisms not only suggest his own English music hall background, but also bears a resemblance to the smoothly maladroit and somewhat effeminate dandy that Linder had created. Sennett's work, however, which started a main line of film comedy lasting from 1912, the year the Keystone Company was founded, through the 1920s and into the first years of sound, was vigorously and indigenously American. It was he who earned the broad popularity for the style known as slapstick, upon which Chaplin was to ring his own subtler changes. Whatever other influences there were, the precedents offered by Edwin Porter and D.W. Griffith would serve Sennett as a way of structuring his films. The chase, characteristic of the filmed action melodramas, could be used for comedy as well as pure suspense. With exciting action situations as backbone, comic muscle and flesh were simply added. Several things are noteworthy about using this format for comic invention. For instance, it is clear that the same Porter-Griffith excitement and suspense of crime, chase and rescue or capture are here turned into comedy by visual and emotional exaggeration. Also, a recognizably real world, unlike that of Millais, is madly distorted as if certain physical laws of gravity, acceleration, solidity of objects, and the like operated in a crazy manner or not at all. The incongruity between what is expected in the real world and what happens in Sennett's universe extends throughout his films. The pleasure we get from this sportive tampering with the expected is the same as would later be offered in animated cartoons. We know that floorboards usually remain in cars, that boilers have no rubbery elasticity, that humans and machines move at predictable speeds, and that no one can drive along the bottom of a lake and come up on the other side. Still, it's fun to have the unlikely made manifest. In Sennett's films, the powerful and socially exalted characters are comic butts, helpless in the face of an onslaught by nature or one of its minions. The choice of policemen is significant in this respect. Although he would turn in his grave at any suggestion of Freudian notions about authority figures as resented parental surrogates, Sennett evidently did realize that the incongruous and the uncomfortable were a lot more humorous when inflicted on types of people who were taken seriously by society and themselves. The indignities to which the grotesque and ineffectual policemen are subjected are funnier because they are policemen. And if soup oiled down a back is amusing, it is at least twice as comical if the back belongs to a plump dowager in an evening gown at a formal function. By puncturing pomposity and pretension, by making the leader and guardians his victims, Sennett heightened our enjoyment. To this extent, there is a social edge to his comedy. It is usually on the side of the little guy in the audience and directed against institutions, conventions, outside his sympathies. This general satirical intentions was even more pointed in the Sennett parodies of certain popular films that he felt suffered from pretentiousness. Barney Oldfield's Race for Life, 1913, for example, was an early kidding of the Griffith last-minute rescue. In the 1920s, the first of the epic westerns, The Covered Wagon, became Sennett's The Uncovered Wagon. Eric von Stroheim's Foolish Wives was lampooned in Three Foolish Weeks. And there was nothing quite like Ben Turpin playing a Rudolph Valentino in The Shriek of Araby to put passion and heroics in proper perspective.